everybody. Can I firstly thank the 67,000 people that were tested to 8 p.m. last night. That is an outstanding result and comes off the back of consecutive days of 50,000 plus tests. Can I please thank the community for coming forward and getting tested with a modicum of symptoms, for following the health advice. That is very pleasing to see, and that will help us fight this very transmissible strain of COVID-19. To 8 p.m. last night, New South Wales recorded 19 cases of community transmission. Pleasingly, 17 of these cases have already been linked. Two are still under investigation. But also, we're asking everybody to make sure that if you're identified as a close contact, that you follow the health advice. But also, we want to thank everybody who has been tested positive for the hours they're spending with our health officials to make sure we're not missing any strains of transmission. Whilst these numbers are stable, they do have the potential, as Dr. Chant and I have said, to bounce around. We anticipate that more cases will arise, especially from household contacts. And I do want to make sure our citizens are fully aware that although we have, I would argue, the best contact tracers in the world, this strain of the virus we haven't seen before, the contagious nature of it, the way it's transmitting, and that's why we're deeply grateful that everybody is respecting, appreciating and following the advice of the lockdown. Just to reiterate also, the decision that was taken at National Cabinet yesterday is that people of all ages, after consulting their GP, will have access to the AstraZeneca. And can I please stress, if you've already had your first jab of the AstraZeneca, please come forward and get your second jab. And obviously everybody can consider their situation in relation to the AstraZeneca jab. But I do also want to stress that until the vast majority of our population is vaccinated, we will have to live differently given this strain of the virus. But I want to assure our citizens that the New South Wales government is already thinking about what life will look like post the lockdown and until we get the vast majority of our citizens vaccinated. It's so important to get our vaccination rates up. I've been very vocal about this from day one, and I'm really encouraging our citizens to come forward and get vaccinated. Dr. Chant will of course go through those cases that I described in some detail and also give her update on the situation we have at hand. I also today wanted to welcome the New South Wales Treasurer who's been busily, Dom Perrottet, who's been busily working on a package on behalf of the New South Wales Government to support our small businesses. We know during our lockdown, which wasn't anticipated, which happened suddenly, has created much stress for small businesses across the state, not just in Greater Sydney and those areas that are in lockdown, but across New South Wales, especially during a time when families would have been holidaying, utilising hospitality venues. So the New South Wales Government, through the leadership of the Treasurer, has put together a package of grants for our small businesses, as well as an extension of our Dine and Discover vouchers, which the Treasurer will outline. And that is really important. We don't want anyone to feel stressed during this lockdown, that they won't be able to manage their household situation or their business situation. And we appreciate the stresses that are there, but we also appreciate how important it is for all of us to respect the health orders to keep the community safe. I also again wanted to thank the Minister for Health and also Deputy Commissioner Warboys for ensuring that Team New South Wales is updated with everything we need, with all the resources we need to keep our citizens safe. I'll now ask Dr. Chant to provide her health update, then the Treasurer will outline the detail of the government's support for small businesses, and then we'll take any of your questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Premier. So as the Premier has indicated, we have had 19 locally acquired cases of COVID in the 24 hours to 8 p.m. last night. 17 of these cases are linked to previously confirmed cases, and the two cases under investigation, one case lives within the eastern suburbs and one case works within the eastern suburbs. In terms of the testing numbers, 67,000 tests were done in the 8 p.m. last night, and can I echo the Premier's appreciation for the community in coming forward? But can I also say a great thank you to all of those pathology workers across the private and public sector all of the staff of those clinics, the administrative staff and the clinical staff who have undertaken that testing and stood up their day and night and worked into the wee hours to get those testing turnaround times maintained and those high rates of testing sustained for the past week. In terms of the cases, seven of the cases were in isolation for infectious period. And as I've indicated, what I want to see in progressive days is that we start seeing all of the cases being effectively isolated that we're announcing. And that's going to be a key indicator of success. At the moment, we are still seeing some cases that were potentially infectious in the community. But what we're hoping is because of the lockdown, the number of interactions those cases have had where there is a potential for transmitting the virus would have decreased significantly. And that is why it is so critical, whilst you are under the stay-at-home provisions, you do minimise your exit to go to retail, you do wear a mask, try and keep your social distancing in all of those environments, and please do not go out, get someone else in your household. If you're at all unwell or any have COVID symptoms, please immediately isolate and get a test and have the daily routine also checking your mobile phone and also watch the website for updated venues of concern. Today's cases include a Rose Bay Secondary School student, and the school site will be closed today for cleaning. All staff and student have been asked to self-isolate until they receive further advice. There's some additional cases linked to the Great Ocean Foods seafood wholesaler in Marrickville, and some additional cases through the West Hoxton Park birthday party. I want to call out some particular venues just to update the community on some advice. In relation to the Christo Pizza at Paddington, remember the venue where there was an infectious person present on the Monday, the 21st of June, from 5:55 p.m. to 8:30 p.m. There have been a number of transmissions at that venue. So please ensure you are following the health advice. Everyone who was there at that time was defined as a close contact. And this, again, the fact that cases are continuing to occur in that setting highlights the absolute importance of adhering to those guidelines. We've also had transmission confirmed at the Doncaster Hotel in Kensington on Wednesday, the 23rd of June. That time was 5:45 p.m. to 8 p.m. The Crossways Hotel at Strathfield South, we have had transmission confirmed on Wednesday, the 23rd of June. The transmission confirmed was from 7 p.m. to 10:30 p.m. And the transmission occurred in someone outside their immediate social group that attended that hotel. So that gives us greater cause for concern when other patrons are impacted. We also know subsequently one of the people that have tested positive also attended that venue on the 26th of June from 3:30 to 5 p.m. There is no transmission yet on that day, but it is critical we will be getting those details out in the public health alert. In relation to the Mascot Meriton Suites Hotel on 200 Coward Street Mascot, we're adding a number of other days that we want to have people get tested. So you are a casual contact if you've been anywhere in the proximity to the Mascot Meriton Suites Hotel, 200 Coward Street Mascot, on the 19th, 21st, 24th and 25th of June. Please get a test and isolate until you have a negative test result. And can I also say, even if you have a single test result that is negative, if you get any other symptoms, you need to retest. And that goes for the community in general. One negative test result does not predict what your result will be later that evening or in subsequent days. And so that leads me to my next key point for today, which is in the last 14 days, we're also particularly wanting to focus on workers or regular visitors to those local government areas of Ballara, Waverley, Randwick and City of Sydney. Clearly, during that period, there was the chance that you may have inadvertently come in contact with someone who is positive, or there may well have been missing links, missing cases in that area. So you may well have gone back to other suburbs in the greater metropolitan Sydney, or for that matter across the state. We are asking you to be very vigilant for symptoms, check those websites, but also get a test with the most minimal of symptoms so we don't, again, miss any further cases. Thank you.
Thanks, Kerry. Well, our message today to every business and every person right across New South Wales is that we've got your back. We've had a very difficult 18 months here in New South Wales, but we've come out stronger the other end. Our economy is larger than it was before the pandemic began, and we've recovered not just every job that was lost, but added over 36,000 more during this period of time. So there is no doubt that as difficult as the last 18 months have been, that we will get through this next couple of weeks. Yes, it's frustrating, but New South Wales will continue the success that we've had over this last period of time. In relation to today's package, I want to say that it continues to focus on keeping businesses in business and people in jobs. And I know and I want to thank all the industry leaders and business leaders who have been working very closely with us over the last 72 hours to put this package together. Importantly, the support package today covers the entire state. It is not simply limited to hotspot areas in metropolitan Sydney. We know that many businesses and individuals in regional New South Wales are also going through a difficult time, particularly in circumstances where this lockdown period has occurred during the holiday season. So in terms of the details today, the New South Wales Government will be providing individual payments to small businesses with full-time employees up to 20 full-time employees, or having payrolls up to $1.2 million with turnover of over $75,000 a year, and that includes sole traders. A payment of $10,000 if there's a turnover reduction of 75%. If there's a turnover reduction of 50%, a $7,000 payment, and if there's a turnover reduction of 30%, a $5,000 payment. This payment will also be available to tourism, hospitality, and the accommodation sector with payrolls of up to $10 million, who we know have been significantly disrupted during this period of time. In addition to that, we will also be deferring any payroll tax liabilities and gaming tax liabilities for hotels for the July period into August. This will provide those impacted businesses with cash flow they need at this difficult period of time. And I want to make the point, particularly to landlords across the state as well, both from a commercial and residential basis, to make sure you're working with your tenants. If tenants are struggling during this period of time, even including on a residential nature, please work with them. As we've said over the last 18 months, we're all in this together. We're deferring those liabilities, and we want to make sure that obviously landlords are also supporting their tenants during this period. As the Premier has said, we're also extending the Dine and Discover vouchers. We had extended it in the budget period to the end of July. We're now going to extend that to the end of August. These vouchers are also available for takeaway and for delivery as well. But we make the point, when you are doing takeaway, obviously use the QR codes as have been set out by the New South Wales Government in relation to that. I also make the point we're providing, the Commonwealth Government is also providing support for individuals and casual workers. So if you're a casual worker, and you've had your hours reduced by greater than 20 hours, you're entitled to $500 per week. Less than that, $325 per week. And I ask that those individuals go to Services Australia to get that information. And finally, as part of today's package, we're also providing support for homelessness. $10.3 million provides support for 3,100 rough sleepers. This program was very successful during the pandemic. In getting people into temporary accommodation. That will be for 14 days during this period of time. And obviously that information can be provided on the Department of Community Services website. So this package today is all about keeping businesses going, giving the cash flow that's required. The funds will be available from July 19. You will need to provide evidence through an accountant in relation to that decline in turnover. But this will provide rapid relief to support businesses recover from this difficult time. Questions?
Treasurer, regarding... trying to discover, just to clarify, can you pick up to take away yourself or must it be delivered?
No, you can pick up take away yourself, but as we say, it's set out very clearly there. But as we say, what we're asking for is that when you are picking up takeaway, that you check in on the QR codes as been set out by the Minister and the Premier.
Just on the grant, a big criticism of the Northern Beaches was that, yes, it was announced, but it took months to actually get the funds. Have you tried to rectify that this time?
Yeah, we think we've streamlined this, and obviously there's a balance between getting money out the door and making sure that it's going in the right places. So what we've said as part of this package is all you'll require is a letter from your accountant going through Service New South Wales, and payments will be available from July 19. This is rapid relief for every business across the state to help them through this period.
What if businesses need money between now and July 19?
What's most important is that we ensure that businesses, that these funds are going to businesses that need it. So getting that money out the door very quickly is what we're focused on, but at the same time, there needs to be evidence of that turnover decline. So what we would say is that period kicks in from an equivalent period in 2019, and you can have that, and those funds will be available for those businesses who have been affected from July 19.
And what about workers? What about workers? Is the federal government thing for workers that have lost hours? That only kicks in, or the money's only provided after the first week of lockdown. Should they get money sooner? Is there anything you can do?
Yeah, I mean, I have raised that with the Federal Treasurer. I mean, we believe that there should be support available to casual workers and individuals from day one to day seven, but more particularly right across the state. What you'll see with our package today is we are not discriminating on whether or not your business is located in a hotspot area or elsewhere across the state, because we know very well that there are many businesses, particularly during the holiday season, right across New South Wales who are doing it tough. And that financial support at the federal level is only provided for those hotspot areas, and I think it's important that it be extended statewide, and that's why we've based our package today on a reduction in turnover, because there's no doubt that there are businesses right across New South Wales who are doing it tough, and we believe this package today will help every business get through this. And as I said, confidence has been crucial in driving our economy during this pandemic, and businesses right across the state, individuals, should have confidence today that the New South Wales government has got your back, and we're going to come through this stronger than ever. No, hotels. It's available for hotels, and that's more just on the sweep. We're not waiving that payroll tax. We are not waiving that gaming tax. We are just deferring it to assist. And if there are payments due or liabilities due in relation to payroll tax, and you can pay, obviously make those payments in the July period. This is just to provide assistance during this next couple of weeks.
We have heard a lot of frustration from the community about not really having an idea of what life will look like when we do reach that kind of magic number of 80% of the adult population vaccinated. What would you like that to look like?
As open and free as any society should be, and that's what success will look like, and that's why the vaccination program is important. If you look just last night, Wimbledon's back on, the Foo Fighters are playing at Madison Square Garden. I mean, that is the environment and the freedom that success looks like, and that's where we'll get to. And ultimately, though, when you have a vaccination rate that is so low, our ultimate responsibility as a state is to protect the vulnerable, and that's what we'll continue to do.
How much money has been allocated in the budget?
Well, I've set aside a provision. Obviously, this will be in the hundreds of millions of dollars, but we will see as we go through this period of time in terms of what the take-up rate is. What I'm focused on is making sure that every single business who needs this support during this period of time gets it.
Premier, can I ask, what did you know about the Prime Minister's AstraZeneca announcement last night? Did you know about that prior to the announcement?
Oh, look, the New South Wales government, it's fair to say, has been extremely vigilant in making sure that all of our citizens who want the vaccine have access to it. As I said yesterday, the one thing out of the control of the New South Wales government is the supply and the doses we receive. But certainly, the New South Wales government will continue to advocate on behalf of our citizens. But I do want to urge everybody who has signed up to get the vaccine, please don't let the lockdown stop you getting the vaccine. The only exception, as Dr. Chant said yesterday, is you have symptoms or you're a close or casual contact, stay home. If you're a close contact, you shouldn't be leaving home. But otherwise, we encourage people as one of the reasons to leave the home to get the vaccine. And I also say to our citizens, not only is the New South Wales government trying to ensure that we have a sense of urgency across the nation about the vaccine rollout, but we're already thinking about what life will look like after the lockdown. And of course, it's early days, but we're looking forward to being able to think about what life looks like after the lockdown, because this Delta variant is very different to what we've seen before. And what we don't want is another lockdown. And so what we'll be looking at is, until our population is vaccinated, and that's why we have a sense of urgency, until at least 80% of our adult population is vaccinated, we can't have a conversation about what COVID normal looks like. And that's why I'm so keen to do everything we can to advocate on behalf of our citizens to ensure not only that we get the supply of doses, but also that there are sufficient points for people to go and get the vaccine.
Did you know about it? Was it discussed in the National Cabinet?
Do
you think there is a chance of lockdown ending before the 2 weeks?
Look, I'll ask Dr. Chant to make that comment. Certainly her advice to us is consistent, and the advice is to make sure that you kill this strain of the virus in the community at the moment. 2 weeks is about what's required. If that advice changes, of course, we'll provide that to the community. But at this stage, do you want to add anything, Dr. Chant? No. So that's advice.
Was the Prime Minister's move?
The Premier said today that the government lost control of this outbreak, and that in hindsight, the lockdown should have happened sooner. John Barilaro said that. Do you agree with those comments?
I agree with Dr. Chant and the health advice. Dr. Chant and the health advice have been adhered to the letter of the law and has stood New South Wales well. And as you see, I have to say it's early days, and I don't want to regret what I'm about to say, but we had anticipated potentially a surge in cases by today. That could very well happen in the next few days, but what it demonstrates to us is the health advice has been pretty much on the money. We did not want to go into lockdown unless we absolutely had to, but certainly what is pleasing to note, and this was verified by the National Chief Medical Officer yesterday in National Cabinet, is that our contact tracers in New South Wales have done an absolutely outstanding job in getting ahead of the virus. At every stage, they've managed to contact the close contacts in a very timely way. And given what this virus has done in other places around the world, New South Wales, touch wood to date, is in a situation where we very much still feel that we're in control of what is happening. Having said that, none of us want to see our community in lockdown. That is not something we wanted to see. But we felt, given the health advice, that that's what we had to do. Well, but I'm very pleased with the health advice and how it stood New South Wales. And again, it's early days, but the contact tracers are now in a position. And as Dr. Chant said, what we will be looking for, based on the health advice, is how many of those new cases are already in isolation. The good news overnight was that 17 out of the 19 cases were already linked, and the other two were in the vicinity of the other cases. So we are very much in a position of being able to assess what is likely to happen at the end of the 2 weeks. But again, that depends on the health advice.
What's the Prime Minister's move announced in
Cabinet? I'll come back to you in a second, yeah.
He's talking about the conversation about what COVID normal will look like when 80% of the population is vaccinated. But all it might look like before then, the Canada's general ruling said yesterday was restrictions be activated and deactivated for years. Will we be in this position for years until 80% of our population is vaccinated?
Well, firstly, there's no doubt that the first step our government has to do is look at what life looks like after the lockdown, because when you know that you've got such a transmissible variant circulating overseas and potentially in people that are coming back home, you do need to look at what life looks like, because what we want to do is prevent ever having to go into lockdown again. So that's the first issue. What does life look like when we come out of this lockdown until around 80% of our population is vaccinated? That's why the sooner our population is vaccinated, the sooner we can get to COVID normal. And I can't stress that enough. Until we get a vast majority of our population vaccinated, we won't get to COVID normal. It's very true. COVID-19 might be around for a long time. We don't know how long it will be around for. We don't know if another virus might emerge. But what we do know is that the vaccines available are very effective. The vaccines available, whilst in Australia we've had early indications that the vaccines are very resistant against this current contagious strain, which is good news. It's positive news. It means that all of us who haven't been vaccinated should be encouraged to come forward and get the vaccine. And certainly in New South Wales, there is a high demand for a safe vaccine.
There's would 50% demand. Would 50% vaccination rate would 50% vaccination rate be enough to avoid a lockdown?
Well, we look at every situation based on the advice we have, but the expert advice, and Dr. Chan has provided this advice to us in New South Wales, is that you need between 75 to 80% of the population to be vaccinated before you can start having conversations about what COVID normal looks like. And so that is the target. I went out on a limb some time ago and said when New South Wales had 10 million jabs, that that would be a position from which we could have those conversations. And also, I appreciate that there are incentive opportunities as well for people who've been vaccinated. But at the moment, that wouldn't be fair because so much of our population wants the vaccine but doesn't have access to it yet. So once we're in a position where there's 10 million jabs, we've already surpassed 2 million jabs, we're 20% of the way there. But of course, that's why I've been so outspoken in relation to what we think, what New South Wales thinks needs to happen to expedite the vaccine rollout and to make sure that when those extra doses arrive later in the year, that everybody who wants the jab has access to it. That is our goal in New South Wales. We're considering, and in fact, we'll be making some further announcements about what the New South Wales government can do to step it up. But we don't control the supply, and we don't control a number of things related to the rollout.
Can you expand on what those announcements might be?
Very soon, yeah. Sorry, you haven't asked the question. Well, at the moment, it's obviously, the health advice suggests that if you're over 60, you should get the AstraZeneca, no questions asked. But obviously, if you're 40 years old, you can consult your GP on whether or not you should take the AstraZeneca vaccine. I'll just ask Dr. Chan if she wants to elaborate on that from a health perspective.
I would suggest that everyone, the first point, anyone who has had a previous AstraZeneca dose, who is due for their second AstraZeneca dose, I would urge them to go forward and get that. There should not be any access problems associated with accessing doses of AstraZeneca, and the rate of any complications, that rare complication of called TTS, thrombosis or clotting disorder, is much reduced in the second dose. And so that's my first message to the community. The second is everyone has their own circumstances. People have underlying health conditions, other medical indications. So my advice would be your GP knows your best. If you want to discuss immunisation with him, your general practitioner is the best person to discuss those risks and benefits on an individual basis with you. But clearly, to echo the Premier's words, we need to sustain and get that population vaccine coverage as soon as possible. I think it's important we go back to the objectives of our vaccine program. We're actually not using vaccination to get rid of the disease, which is a bit like what we're doing with measles, where we know that if we get 95% of the vaccinated population, we can have these minor incursions, but then stomp it out. Even at 80% of the 80% of the population protected, we will still see COVID able to transmit in the population, and that's what the Premier is talking about in terms of what living with COVID means. What we are doing at the moment with the vaccine rollout is twofold. We are trying to vaccinate the most vulnerable in our community. So the vaccines are very effective at stopping hospitalisations and death, one of the severe consequences of COVID. We also have had subsequent information around the fact that they do also have an impact on transmission. The second group we're trying to vaccinate is all those workers that come into contact with returned overseas people, be that crew, flight crew, ports, or our returned travellers in the quarantine system. And the reason for that is we're trying to stop any incursions. We're using a layered approach with vaccination being part of that layer to protect us against these incursions. Now, if we divert vaccines from an older age group to a younger age group, we're not going to have that much of an impact on transmission because not enough of them will be vaccinated. And secondly, the people that are progressively more likely to have consequences for COVID are those across all age groups that have got underlying health conditions, and people in the younger age groups that have had underlying health conditions have been eligible for a while for the vaccine. But as you get older, your impact of COVID and your likelihood of hospitalisation and death is greater, and that is why those age cohorts have been prioritised.
Dr. Chalmers, to the store.
Medical centre today. I'm 31. I contacted them to get an AstraZeneca shot. They said they won't do it this week, but I call back next week and I get a Pfizer shot. So what's going on there? Why is this advice?
Okay. So at the moment, we know that the supplies from the Commonwealth in relation to Pfizer are going to increase in upcoming periods. And we know that the Commonwealth have also started to roll out Pfizer through some general practice settings, particularly the GP respiratory clinics that the Commonwealth had funded and set up through the pandemic. So I don't know the specifics of the surgery you rang, but it may well be that they're one of the early adopters that are being brought on to roll out the Pfizer, and therefore that is why you're able to access the Pfizer vaccination. And what I would ask the community to do is there are going to be increasing opportunities to get vaccinated, and as you become eligible for either the Pfizer or the AstraZeneca, please take up those opportunities, have those discussions with your healthcare practitioners. Vaccination is essential if we are going to return to some COVID normalcy.
Dr. What are the total numbers of...
You've allowed retail to open, so including non-essential retail, like an Amazon shop or a Bed Bath & Tables. So why some of those stores allowed to open when considering the rules to leave the house that are only essential purchases?
I think what we've realised is practically it's impossible to define essential retail, because clearly if you've just relocated house and you have nothing with you, getting some bath towels and some products are essential. But we know that the retailers themselves will depend on the traffic. We are working with the community to say over these 2 weeks, the more you can do with minimising any, you know, really we're saying go out for essential goods. Therefore, the retailers will calibrate their opening hours, and many of the small retailers will close because, in essence, people are not out and about. And I thank the community for applying common sense. I'd also just segue to the other thorny issue of outdoor exercise. We just ask everyone to apply common sense and do not... The principle is we do not want people coming in contact with other people. Our preference would be that people are not travelling large distances to avail themselves of outdoor exercise opportunities when it's just around the corner from you. Please, can we apply common sense? The less interactions we can have over this next 2 weeks will give us the greatest confidence. And we do need 2 weeks, and it doesn't matter when you do the lockdown. If you're doing a lockdown because of concern of unlinked cases and cases that need to be unearthed, you need a long enough period of time. And 2 weeks has been the estimate that I've provided advice to the government. Obviously, we look at the data every day, but I would not at this period of time be considering that we would be in the position before that period.
Just in relation to the young woman that is in hotel quarantine who needs to go to Victoria, but she can't afford the charter flight, is there anything that we can do to help that woman?
Look, I think the Minister, I understand, could answer that question.
Look, obviously there have been some very challenging personal circumstances over this entire pandemic. New South Wales has certainly tried to be helpful and accommodating with families who...